while we get Paul's slide deck ready, that one of the reasons I truly admire Paul Blanche and consider him to be a personal hero is because he had the courage to risk everything as a whistleblower at a nuclear power plant back in the 1990s. Paul blew the whistle because the company was refusing to acknowledge important safety issues involving radiation and natural gas pipeline safety. The story was front page news with national implications and resulted in lasting reforms. Mr. Blanche, you may continue to part two of your presentation.
Okay, thank you again, Charles, and thank you, Kathy, for your phenomenal presentation. This is the second part, and I'm going to be addressing two different other regulations that I didn't totally cover in part one. This first photo shows the power of the Pacific Ocean in the vicinity of San Onofre. This part of my presentation is about the federal regulation that requires the retrievability of spent fuel at San Onofre, and we'll also cover a little bit more on criticality. These are regulations that have been just totally ignored by Edison and by the NRC and, of course, by Holtec. Next slide. Retrievability is one of the most vital aspects of the safe storage of spent fuel in the storage facility at San Onofre and other existing storage sites. This definition is essentially one sentence, and it's very clear. And it's mandated. There's no excuse for not complying with it. And it says retrievability. Storage systems, which we have 120 some, must be designed to allow ready retrieval of a spent fuel. Not the canister, but the spent fuel, high-level radioactive waste, and reactor-related GTCC, which stands for greater than Class C waste, for further processing and disposal. And the same Part 72 regulation states, except as specifically authorized by the Commission in writing, no interpretations of the meaning of these regulations in this part by any officer or employee of the commission, other than written interpretation by the general counsel, will be recognized as binding on the commission. Again, the NRC commission has ignored this. The next slide. The NRC, with the assistance of industry lobbying groups such as the Nuclear Energy Institute, has made every effort to change this regulation and avoid major financial impact on utilities by a concerted effort to change the interpretation, avoiding the long formal rulemaking process described in part two of the regulations. Compliance for each plant would be tens of millions, would add tens of millions to the decommissioning costs. In direct conflict with these regulations of the law, the NRC has developed a sneaky workaround. With full knowledge, the NRC has essentially changed the intent of the retrievability regulations to allow sites to meet this law by demonstrating that the canister, not the fuel, storage is acceptable without the ability to ever access the spent fuel, thus saving billions of dollars for the nuclear industry. No need for a hot cell or a spent fuel pool. The NRC did all this behind closed doors. However, it was eventually published in the Federal Register, which does not meet the requirements for formal rulemaking requirements. Why should we care about retrievability? Again, the NRC knowingly violated its own regulations. Federal law requires that nuclear waste storage system be designed, ready retrieval means you can easily get to the spent fuel, not the canisters, and move, inspect, and repair if necessary. That's the federal requirement, retrievability, not cask relocation. Non-compliance is not an option, but forcing the NRC may take action and require legal formal challenge, which certainly we don't have the resources to do such. Retrievability is required because of the following. Without this capability, we can never inspect, repair, or transfer the fuel to any long-term facility, and it is a federal law, both in the Energy Reorganization Act, approved by Congress, and 10 CFR. It may be necessary for the eventual transportation from the present location. It is necessary for fuel inspection and repair. As Charles pointed out, these things are all degrading and they cannot be inspected or repaired. Without the retrievability, the risk to the public and the future generations is significantly increased. They're required for long-term geological disposal. Unless we have the capability to retrieve the fuel, we can't have geological disposal. And required for possible reprocessing, something I don't think is ever going to be considered. Slide 5, federal regulations prohibit the NRC from changing or reinterpreting the regulations in 10 CFR 72 that I am aware of. This was done by the issuance of a new device called an Industry Staff Guidance, or ISG 1, 2, and 3, thus totally changing the intent of the regulation on retrievability. Next slide. This is a photo of the equipment required to move a canister at San Onofre. As you can see in this picture, there's not a trivial job. It takes extreme effort, time, equipment, personnel, and significant radiological exposure to workers to actually remove one of these canisters from its current locations. So in the event of an emergency like a giant storm, there's essentially no way for these things to be moved in a timely fashion. With the encased salts and debris, the canister may not be able to be removed from the vertical ventilation module. If you've got to take a salt at the bottom, it's certainly going to increase the friction between the canister and the VVM. Now, Holtec has produced a final safety analysis report where it discusses procedures for unloading the high storm UMAC system in the spent fuel pool. When I saw this, it sounded very interesting, but then I read it. Apparently, Edison has no concerns. The spent fuel pools are planned to be demolished shortly. This conscious decision was approved by the California Coastal Commission, apparently with no knowledge and total disregard of federal requirements, but will it significantly reduce decommissioning expenses? This is the most egregious example of Holtec, a subcontractor to Edison, lying to the NRC and the public by stating, quote, if the MPC cavity cannot be successfully returned to a safe, analyzed condition, the fuel must be placed in a safe condition in the spent fuel pool. They don't mention there is none. The completion time is reasonable based on the time to reflood the MPC. 24 hours, no, it's not. Cut the MPC wells, which can only be done in a pool. Move the transfer cast into the spent fuel pool. Remove the MPC lid and remove the spent fuel assemblies in an orderly manner without challenging personnel. These are the only legally binding words, and they talk about the spent fuel and the pool, which is not going to be there. Next slide. The High Storm 100 system, which is almost identical to the UMAC system, unloading procedures describe the general actions necessary to prepare the MPC for flooding, for unloading. Special precautions are outlined to ensure personnel safety during the unloading operations and prevent the rest of the MPC overpressurization, and thermal shock to the storage of the spent fuel assemblies. Nobody knows what happens when you take 800 degree canisters and put them into cold water if it were available. There are no provisions discussed to prevent thermal shock when the canister is submerged in cold water and the consequences are unknown. The High Storm 100 system canister is almost identical to the UMAX system employed at San Onofre. The NRC must take some type of enforcement action for these false statements by Southern California Edison's contractor, Holtec, but they won't. Slide 9. This part of the FSAR clearly requires all cooling and canisters must be restored within 24 hours or damage will occur. That's a pretty bold statement. That's right in their legally binding tech specs. More than 24 hours, damage is going to occur. We know that in flooding, they can't do it. We know this to be impossible, and there will likely be a major release of radioactivity into the environment that may persist for years, such as Fukushima and Chernobyl. Next slide. This is the cover page from the 671-page UMAX FSAR. The document has to be totally revised to address compliance with potential flooding issues, criticality, and retrievability, and also emergency planning. Could this analysis conclude an unacceptable risk to the public, then Edison must consider installing a hot cell and constructing a hardened structure with thick walled cast, as shown in the upcoming slides, thus demonstrating regulatory compliance to meet the federal requirements for flooding retrievability and criticality. Next slide, please. We must demand that Edison retain the spent fuel pools until a suitable hardened structure is constructed, as shown in this particular photo. Where do we go from here? Summarize, we must have the licensee of the NRC provide an accurate analysis for flooding retrievability and criticality, provide a hardened for seismic and tsunami resistance structure with thick wall cast for flood and tsunami protection, and a terrorist deterrent meeting federal siting requirements. We must continue our attempts to reestablish a dialogue with the NRC chairman, the commissioners, the Office of Public Affairs, the NRC staff, and the NRC's inspector general. Reiterate our numerous requests with the NRC technical staff for a public meeting per commission policy. We must update the final safety analysis report, demonstrating compliance with all federal regulations. Based on the evaluation, we need to evaluate emergency planning based on realistic accident dose rate. We will attempt to work to accelerate the NRC Inspector General investigation, and we must retain the spent fuel or a hot cell, demonstrating regulatory compliance for the short term. Why does the NRC refuse to enforce its regulation? The answer is quite simple, that no nuclear power plants commercial would be economical if the regulations were enforced. Next slide, please. Let your feelings be known by your elected officials, letters to the news media, and to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. I have provided some titles here. Please do it. It'll make a difference. Concluding remarks of significant. NRC may also be present tonight here for this presentation, but we will not be putting them on the spot, asking them any questions at this time. That is not the purpose of our meeting. However, we will provide the opportunity to the NRC and Edison should they decide to make a brief statement tonight. From my perspective, living 2,500 miles away from San Onofre, my family and I are safe from this impending disaster. I may have a different opinion if I were residing in Southern California. I say this after sleeping on a nuclear submarine for months on end, 100 feet from a safe nuclear power reactor. A special thanks to Doug Wood for his audiovisual expertise. We would not have been able to produce this presentation without his assistance. And very importantly, we look forward to working toward a future resolution of these significant safety issues and reiterate our invitation to the NRC, Edison, and the community engagement panel for a productive professional meetings